with Dr. Ann Klaeysen. Ann Klaeysen, as you all know, is a leader of the New York Society for Ethical Culture. She holds a Doctor of Ministry degree in pastoral counseling from Hebrew Union College, as well as master's degrees in German from the State University of New York at Albany, and business administration from New York University. Dr. Klaeysen is the ethical humanist religious life advisor at Columbia University and humanist chaplain at NYU. She also participates in several interfaith social justice coalitions. Dr. Klaeysen.
Good morning. I'm going to lower this a little bit and turn on the light. Cool. Didn't this used to be on the other side?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thanks. There we go. You can see me now, right? Okay. Terrific. All righty. Thank you for the neighborhood. That was lovely. Did you all see the documentary about Mr. Rogers? Wasn't it lovely? Oh, gosh. Yeah, it's a reminder, isn't it? And that's what Jane Addams and John Lovejoy Elliott did, is they reminded folks that we're all human beings, that we're all neighbors. And it really is very simple to be nice to one another, to say good morning and how are you, and wait and listen to the response. So I'm delighted to be sharing some stories about these two lovely people. So first of all, let me give you just some facts about them. Jane was the elder. Jane Addams was born on September 6th, 1860. John Lovejoy Elliott was born on December 2nd, 1868. Jane Addams grew up in wealth. Her family were very well off, and she was in the Chicago area. John Lovejoy Elliott's family, not so much. They weren't rich, they weren't poor. They were, I guess, what we would call solidly middle class. They were farmers. And so they grew what they needed on their farm and had enough to share with their neighbors. Jane Addams started Hull House in Chicago with her friend Ellen Gates Starr in September 1889, and that was in Chicago. John Lovejoy Elliott started Hudson Guild in Chelsea, which was then called the Wild West. Very different from what it is now, right? In 1895. The two of them met at summer school. They met at the Ethical Culture Summer School, which Anna Garland Spencer started. And they met in Plymouth, Massachusetts, and had by that time a great deal to share. John was a lifelong bachelor. Although he had many admirers, and there were many stories told about him, but nobody knew for sure. Talk to Kurt Collier, he has some ideas. he'll be later in the spring. Jane, on the other hand, had what was referred to at the time as a Boston marriage. And what that meant was that she had a partner for life. And that partner was Mary Rosett Smith. And they were, for all intents and purposes, married. In fact, Hull House was kind of a hotbed for other life partners, female life partners. And it was considered a place where the wealthy could send their daughters. And I'm sort of jumping ahead of the story right now, but I'll come back to it. I just think it's a delicious tidbit about Hull House, right? Because Hull House and Hudson Guild were part of the Settlement House movement. And the philosophy behind the Settlement House movement was very different from traditional religions. I grew up Catholic, my husband grew up Jewish. In both of those traditions, there are very important charitable institutions. But they really Their clients were Catholics and Jews, respectively, and sometimes they did reach out to people from other traditions. In the case of Jewish organizations, they didn't expect anyone to convert, but in the case of Catholic organizations, they did. And so there was certainly that aspect of conversion. What was lovely about the Settlement House movement as a philosophy was that it took the principles of ethical culture to heart. Now, I'm not saying not all settlement houses were ethical culture, but they certainly were all ethical. And you know the Henry Street Settlement with Lillian Wald and other settlement houses. What they did was so different from that religious philanthropy. What they said was, we want to live in the neighborhood. We want to be good neighbors. And we're not going to tell you what you want or what you need. Only you know that. We're going to listen to you. We're going to hear you. And then we're going to put everything that we can into that community. We're going to put our own resources, financial, intellectual, ethical, and we know a whole lot of other people who would like to do good things, and so we're going to let them do it here. And in the case of young girls at that time, and when did I say that it was, she founded it, 1889. Okay, there weren't a whole lot of choices for women, certainly not women of the upper class. There were working women, we know working women, because they were on the farms, they were in the cotton mills, they were in the factories. We know right here the Triangle Shirtwaist Company and the fire that they had. There were plenty of women working there. But if you were upper class and your parents were wealthy, you had to get married. And you had to get married to someone your family chose. You could be a teacher, but you could only be a teacher until you got married. Or you could be maybe a governess for someone else's family. If you were a spinster, you chose not to get married, maybe you would continue to be a teacher, maybe you would be the good aunt to your nieces and nephews. But Jane Addams was well known. And when she started Hull House, other parents said, "Ooh, we'll send our girls there." What they didn't know was that they became feminists. This was a feminist think tank. They reached out to the professors at the Chicago University. John Dewey loved Hull House, and he gave lectures there. The professors at the University of Chicago gave lectures at Hull House, and guess what? People really listened to them. They weren't just there for a degree. They weren't there to hobnob and make good connections. At Hull House, they were hungry to learn, and learn they did. One of the stories about Jane Addams is that she decided to get politically active. But the way she did it was through the sanitation department. Yes. Because when you live in a neighborhood, you know that if the garbage isn't picked up, if it's left there to fester, if things aren't clean, people will get sick and they will die too early. And so she took it upon herself in her district in Chicago to become the head of the sanitation department. John Lovejoy Elliott, for his part, was very involved in criminal justice. In fact, when he was at Cornell University, he grew up in the Midwest. And so they had a history there. His family was part of the abolitionist movement in the Midwest. And they sent him east to go to Cornell. And so he met Elliot. Elliot met Adler. And he met him when did he meet him? In 1889, so just about the time when Jane Addams was setting up Hull House in Chicago, John Lovejoy Elliott was meeting Felix Adler at Cornell. Adler didn't stay at Cornell too long. He went there after giving the first and last sermon at Temple Emmanuel. He had a chair at Cornell, and Cornell, the Board of Trustees, decided that he was too radical to stay at Cornell, so he left there just as he left Temple Emmanuel because he was too radical for them. Not too radical for us. So that's why he founded Ethical Culture in 1876. But he went back to visit, and one of the reasons he went back to Cornell to visit was to recruit new leaders. And he saw in John Lovejoy Elliott someone who would be an excellent leader, and he was right. One of the things that Elliott was particularly drawn to was criminal justice, because not too far from Ithaca is Elmira, New York, in the southern tier. And there was a prison there. And so he was really drawn to prison reform, because the prison in Elmira was not a good one. Well, none of them were at that time. And so with Adler's encouragement to become an ethical culture leader, John Lovejoy Elliott traveled to Germany, because at that time, Adler still believed that the universities here weren't quite as good as the ones in Germany. So that first generation of leaders got sent back there. So Elliott went, he got his doctorate there in prison reform. And he came back, and he had a lot to do with it here in New York, because when he started Hudson Guild, there was a gang. And that gang in Chelsea was called the Hurly Burly Boys. And the Hurly Burly Boys were a rough bunch. And it's interesting. What he did is similar to what a lot of teachers do today, and certainly something that the faculty and administrators at my children's elementary school did years ago. They had a program at my children's school where they would train students to be peer counselors in the playground. And first they had to identify who those students would be. And so they allowed the children, their fellow students, to do some voting, but the faculty did as well, and it was weighted. And the ones who were chosen to be the peer counselors in the playground were those who had been identified as having leadership skills, but sometimes in antisocial ways. They were the bullies. And so they were able to use their leadership skills in the playground. I remember my son being upset that he wasn't chosen. Meanwhile, I knew, that's right, because you're not a bully. Elliott did something similar with the Hurly Burly Boys. He identified who were the leaders there. And so what he did was he rented an apartment for them in Chelsea where they could get together, where they could meet, where they could play ball. What's the first thing they did? They threw things out the window. Defenestration, that's what they did. And years later, when he bought a farm upstate, Hudson Guild Farm, which has alas been sold to developers, when he bought that farm and brought his mother and his brother from the Midwest to farm that farm, what was the first thing they did when they got to the farm? They threw furniture out the windows. It seemed to be a rite of passage for the Hurly Burly Boys that he could never understand. But once he understood that they were going to do it, he just made sure he replaced the windows and went on from there. Since Jane Addams comes a little earlier, I'm going to bounce back and forth a little bit and find, you know, some connection. So they're really getting two platforms in one here. But I think it's important because our theme for this month is urban life. And you know, so much has been talked about now about how we living in cities, perforce, we must get along with each other. We take public transportation. We're on the buses, we're on the subways. And yes, according to an article in the business section of the New York Times last Sunday, most of us are looking at our devices and not looking up at each other. Still, we share these same spaces together. And many is the time when we will connect with other people, especially when there's an adorable child or an older person who needs help, right? We all connect. We help that person in and out of the subway, in and out of the bus. So we have something going for us living in an urban area. And so that's kind of what both Jane Addams and John Lovejoy Elliott had going for them, that people already were connecting with one another. But what they didn't have was power, right? So they could help to empower their neighbors in those communities. So as I mentioned, one of the things that Jane Addams did was to bring folks together into Hull House. The first thing that she did, and you notice, you see sort of a pattern here. So Elliot rents an apartment and has the boys come in and they can have their games there. She, because she's got more money, buys a house. And in that house, she decorates it. She brings in beautiful works of art. She furnishes it with upholstered furniture. And people come in through the door and they don't know what to make of it, because they're living in tenements. They're living several families in one apartment. And they walk into this house and they're afraid to touch anything. They don't know what to say. Many of them don't speak English. And she welcomes them. This is your home. This is your home. You can sit wherever you want. And then she invites, as I said before, other people in to offer them classes. So they're not only learning, they're also forming a sewing circle. They're learning to improve their language skills. They're helping one another. And they're bringing their children and they're reading children's stories to them. So here's a story. She loved to tell, Jane Addams and others would read stories, and so she tells the story about Roland, the young heroes, and Scheherazade, and these kids just, they come around, and you'd say, any evening after 4 o'clock, you may see boys running to Hull House, disdaining the joys of craps, to hear tales of King Arthur and Prince Roland. One evening, never to be forgotten by one small boy, the Charlemagne stories came to an end after a whole long winter of them. He ran out of the door, rubbing the tears away from his rough little, with his rough little fist and crying, "There's no good in coming anymore. Prince Roland is dead." I can't imagine. Can you just imagine for a moment what that must have been like, right? It was a very mean existence, right? You get up before the sun, right? If you're lucky, you had some breakfast, maybe some oatmeal, stale bread. You go off to your job, right? You go to your job in the factories and the mills, and then you come home probably after the sunset.